It is my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Rita Colwell as our opening keynote speaker for this morning. Dr. Colwell has pioneered research on global infectious diseases, water and health in the developed and developing world. She has held many advisory positions in the US government, including serving as the director of the National Science Foundation, as well as in the international scientific research community. 4 years ago, she was awarded the rank of Chevalier in the Legion of Honor by decree of the President of the French Republic. She also serves as a board director for the Global Council for Science and the Environment. Dr. Colwell.
Thank you for the kind introduction and for inviting me to participate in this very important conference. I feel very comfortable, if you could show the slides, I feel very comfortable speaking to this group because, in fact, the theme of sustainability is clearly critical for an understanding of maintaining stability and continuity on a globe such as planet Earth. My focus is really on safe water and the diseases transmitted through water. If we don't have safe water and a water supply for populations, then of course we will suffer severe consequences as a global population. As you can see, water-related diseases are a major source of infections in humans throughout the world. I'm going to focus on cholera because, frankly, I've worked on cholera for the last 40 years, and we have learned a great deal about it. We made the discovery, next slide, that the causative agent of the cholera disease is water transmitted, and it's naturally occurring in the environment. Cholera occurs in 50 countries. There are at least 2 million cases every year. We are, in fact, in the seventh pandemic of cholera. We have been in two pandemics, but of course, the COVID-19, a rapid, fulminating, and highly pathogenic in a very quick way, has taken naturally and logically taken the attention of the world. However, cholera, waterborne diseases and cholera remain a problem. As you can see, the source of the water is not necessarily safe. And in fact, what we learned about cholera from our studies in the United States and in other countries is that the bacterium is in the environment and it is the source of the agent, and that is transmitted person to person under conditions of poor sanitation, lack of access to clean water. May I have the next slide, please? So we have learned a lot about this disease, and we're able to take what we have learned to apply to COVID-19. Now, first, let me point out, because cholera bacteria are in the environment associated with plankton, and the phytoplankton component of plankton carry chlorophyll, this can be measured by satellite sensing. And we have determined that we could, in fact, measure by satellite the concentration of chlorophyll and sea surface temperature and sea surface height. And we could use satellite sensing as a predictor for cholera in the developing world particularly. And this correlation, the red are the cases of cholera in Bangladesh, and the blue is the chlorophyll and sea surface temperature measurements just off the coast of the Bay of Bengal. So the correlation was very powerful. So this allowed us, with more sophisticated satellites in the last 20 years, because that first publication was 20 years ago, that showed this relationship of satellite sensing and prediction capability. We now have improved with all of the highly sophisticated satellites that have been made available, including JASON, for example, the upper right, which allows us to measure within a 1 meter quadrant some of the parameters, as well as movement of populations. This has allowed us then to apply to what occurred in Yemen in 2017, the worst cholera epidemic we have historically recorded. In Yemen, we have now developed a very sophisticated cholera prediction that allows us to anticipate ahead of time, based on environmental parameters, when and where the outbreaks will occur. The forecasted risk is critical because in cholera, they have high poverty rates, frequent droughts, water access is quite limited. And so we have been working with UNICEF and the World Health Organization and the United Nations through our connection with the UK Office of Development to provide prediction maps for cholera in Yemen. The reason we want to do this, as you can see in the bottom left in the diagram, if we can, with the red line, if we can predict, we can prevent the black lines, the numbers of cases of cholera by anticipating moving healthcare measures, moving personnel, like Doctors Without Borders and the UN capabilities. But if we wait until the cholera outbreak occurs, which is the slot, the curve B, then we will have so many cases of cholera that we could have prevented but didn't. And so we have then, with our risk map in our risk model, the left, we're able to predict where the red lines, the red coloring and the yellow coloring show the intensity, relative intensities of risk. And then on the bottom right, you can see where the actual cases occurred. So we have now achieved 60 to 70% accuracy as to where and when we can predict cholera. May I have the next slide, please? Now, we've been able to adapt this to the COVID-19 because it too is driven by environmental factors. It's driven by humidity and temperature and movement of populations. And so you can see the risk map for last year, April to May 2020, our risk map, and then you can see to the right the actual cases, and you can see that that early model for COVID modified from cholera was reasonably effective. We were able then to improve it. This is April 2021 in the upper right, upper left, and the bottom right of the actual cases, and so we are now able to provide about a 60% to 70% accuracy of COVID that allows us then to provide a predictive capacity. More to the point, by using DNA sequencing, we can address the safety of water directly, ground truth, if you will, being able to measure the presence of the bacteria using DNA extraction of water samples and then identifying the bacteria. We did this first study with Orange County, California, where they are reusing sewage water because of the drought conditions to purify for drinking water. We were able very quickly to show that the gray area are all the kinds of bacteria in the sewage water going into the drinking water plant, but after treatment, you can see from the bottom left, the only bacteria left in the last stages of treatment are the typical water bacteria that you would find in unpolluted water. And also the treatment works with viruses. You can see the Q1, which is the sewage water coming in, and then the treatment reduces the virus concentration. We also can show we remove antibiotic resistance genes by the treatment. But in drinking water, different types have a microbiome. We all know the fact that the COVID-19 virus affects the lungs, the liver, the kidneys, and the intestines. It's been shown the yellow line and the red lines, if you read from the top to the bottom, these are different patients. The red line shows that they are positive by the nasal throat swab. The yellow line shows they release the bacteria, the virus, weeks later, so that we're able then to determine, have the next slide. In Maryland, we're doing studies now showing that we can detect two or three a week, or let's say 10 days, 2 weeks or 10 days ahead of the actual cases, we can detect in the sewage the presence of the virus. And so putting together this prediction and this direct ground truth detection, we now have the capability of being able to be ahead of the virus, which has all come from what we knew, what we are doing, addressing the problems of this new pandemic, and being able to learn from the ongoing cholera pandemic. And so this, we must keep in mind that we are in the COVID-19 pandemic, but look, we have suffered pandemics periodically. We will have another pandemic. It might be COVID-2020 or COVID-2022, but we need to be prepared. And so I'm going to simply say that we learned from what we had studied on cholera to help today those villagers who are not going to have access to large-scale sanitation or large-scale water treatment. We have developed the fact that we know the bacteria associated with plankton. We have instructed the villagers that they can filter the water using used sari cloth, which gives them clean water. They rinse the sari cloth after use, refold it for the next use. It gives them relatively clean water to the rice. It reduces cholera by 50%. So here we're able to take our scientific knowledge, give it to villagers who can then apply it and be protected from cholera at the same time that we're doing sophisticated prediction of where and when the outbreaks will occur. And water, safe water, is a challenge for sustainability, a challenge for the future. And I can't resist saying much of this is written in a book that I published just last year. And I thank you very, very much for the opportunity to speak with you for this very important conference, which is, I think, very necessarily focused on education during a time of severe social disruption, but we can come out of it with new knowledge and safe practices. Thank you.